This is We Are Netflix, Netflix employees talking about work and life at Netflix.
What Netflix is doing right now is creating and giving a forum for great storytellers around the world to create. And that diffusion of decision-making that we have at Netflix will enable us to make great choices all around the world.
5 years ago, Netflix only served customers in the US and Canada. But now we stream to 190 different countries. Our challenge is to make sure that the movies and TV shows that we create represent the globe. I'm Lyle Troxell, and in this episode of We Are Netflix, we'll take a closer look at how this vision is taking shape in one of the countries we serve. Recently, my family and I were lucky enough to vacation in Japan, so I took a day to visit our Tokyo office and speak with two of the people leading our content creation there. John Derderian, who we just heard from in the opening clip, is director of content for Netflix Japan. He's in charge of all our Japanese content development. And Taito Okiura is director of international originals, specializing in anime. Taito is well known in the anime world. He headed up his own studio, David Productions, before joining Netflix. I started by asking Taito how it feels to work at Netflix compared to running his own company.
I've noticed that the feeling of having a lot of freedom feels very much like you're a small business person or a contractor, in the sense that you're like, you're doing what makes sense to you most of the time. Taito, does it feel that way coming from an entrepreneur where you're running your own business, you're doing your own production company, coming into a larger company? Does it feel different to you than running your own thing?
Surprisingly, pretty much similar. This is a big corporation with startup mind, and people in Tokyo office assumes Netflix culture very seriously. People have some commitment to the radical openness and honesty and candidness. We have this credo, silent disagreement is disloyal, per Netflix culture. However, Japanese proverb says, silence is golden. And people with Confucianism culture respect seniority, but after all, it's all about high performance. People committed to the high performance, then practice our openness and honesty in our own way. So we are a long way to improve our global EQ. However, we are trying day by day.
And have you found challenges in managing people that come from a different company and coming in and changing their culture? Do they find it refreshing? Is it challenging?
Basically, hiring is very tough in this market.
Why?
So we need to hire someone who are very good at with the business and also who can speak English fluently. This English fluency is a big challenge for us. And also this, you know, cultural commitment is another challenge. Some people say this organization is not for everyone. So those people who join Netflix already have some adaptability to open culture. That's my view.
We're looking for people that have experience and have proven themselves in some level, right, within the existing kind of industry and ecosystem. But there's an itch. They're kind of chafing at some element of the culture. And when we come to them, they say, ah, this might be the solution. Freedom, ownership. You mentioned the word ownership. That's a really key for us, because that's how I think we're able to work very quickly and independently, right, and have the context, not control. That sense of someone owning a part of the business, being the thought leader around that, I think that that's really critical. And it's something that we, in the process of interviewing folks, we think a lot about.
Okay, you say ownership, but this is a subsidiary of a California company, right?
Yes.
Do you have to run things through the head office?
Listen, I mean, I think the power of Netflix is there's not a choke point at the top. There's a lot of trust across the organization. That's how we have a freedom and responsibility culture. We feel like we hire people that can make those decisions, are confident to make those decisions, and are going to exercise good judgment in those decisions. And that includes the buying that we do here, the original commissions we do here. We talk about them a lot. We debate them. We discuss them. But ultimately, we have a lot of autonomy to make choices.
What kind of choice have you made in your role here that would be surprising to someone in a different company?
Something like Pacific Rim is a show that, you know, we sought out to make as an anime. We went to Legendary. We created a partnership. Fantastic fit. The original IP is developed by Guillermo del Toro, and Legendary into film franchise is so suitable for anime.
Oh yeah,
has so much DNA of anime in it already in terms of the.
It's
mecha.
A transformation of, if it's an anime piece,
right,
has to be a film.
Yeah, and now we're bringing it back to anime.
Do you focus on more than just anime? Correct. I did. Taito's, you're anime focused, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So what were the other genres that you're working on?
Really, it's just live action and anime. Okay. Anime is such a big part of our content creation out of Japan and content licensing that we put a lot of resources to it. So I spend a lot of my time doing that, working with Taito, working with the rest of the team.
Why is anime so important in Japan?
Because Japan uniquely creates it. There are some anime shows we do create outside of Japan.
It's debatable whether that's anime.
Yeah, and there's a lot of debate about that. But we believe they are because we believe they're created by people that love and respect and are imbued with the anime culture. Mm-hmm. But most of the anime is created in Japan, obviously, and it travels very broadly across Netflix. It's a category that has an audience and a fandom truly globally.
Definitely. Why is the anime art form, especially 2D anime art form, what's so powerful about it?
Japan is full of very strong IPs. Those manga stuff like Dragon Ball, My Hero Academia, and Godzilla, they're very popular and it's locally strong, but it also has strong high awareness on the global market. And anime is very unique to tell such characters and IPs in the narratives.
What's unique about it?
The art form doesn't rely on specific live-action actors and actresses. So those characters have a high probability to travel outside Japan compared with locally produced live-action genre. Mm-hmm. Some people believe that, you know, Pokemon anime came from U.S. So anime is country origin agnostics, you know, sometimes.
Yeah, yeah. That's a wonderful thing for people to feel it's part of them. And that's what you want almost all art to be, right? You want them to feel like they're connected to it.
And also, anime is an art form that has a good fit with internet and social media. These 15 or 12 years was a very tough time for anime industry because of internet piracy. Historically, anime was in the small corner of rental video store. I lived in Los Angeles 20 years ago, and I went to Hollywood Video or Blockbusters, and you know, store guide, you know, approached me. Hey, I saw this Akira movie. That's a very good stuff, and oh, you know that's a very good stuff. But we didn't have, you know, opportunity outside that small corner. Then we have a big boom of Japanese anime, and the DVD was the main distribution media.
Yeah.
However, about 12 years ago, the internet piracy destroyed the market for non-Japanese anime distribution forever.
Why do you think it did that?
People are so passionate about it, but there are these sites called fansub, where people voluntarily make subtitles, then redistribute Japanese anime.
So they're almost mixing up a new piece with the
yeah. So the monetization opportunity was gone.
Oh man! And that means everybody's suffering. That's in the art form, right? Because they're not getting any money.
I was in Japanese animation business for about 15 years, but at that time I had a very hard time to survive. But this internet piracy, ironically, expanded the fan base.
Yeah.
And there's this new young generation who grew up with anime. Then this legitimate internet broadcasting has come of age. Then monetization opportunity came back.
Yeah.
Then I'm here. It's unbelievable for me. But I'm so grateful, Netflix, for giving me this, you know, great opportunity.
Yeah.
And there are many stunning colleagues, you know, who passionately work on anime. And our anime offering is, you know, expanding. And every show of Netflix, you know, this Altered Carbon anime, sure, Pacific Rim anime, and
Ghost in the Shell.
Ghost in the Shell. Every project is, for me, once in a lifetime career project.
And you're doing lots of them.
Yes.
Wait, I love that the three you just mentioned are all have become popular. I mean, Ghost in the Shell, of course, had a popular movie, live-action movie variant recently that kind of booted its knowledge in the U.S. to a broader audience. And then, of course, Altered Carbon is a pretty successful show of ours, which, of course, is also a live-action. And we're making and of course, Pacific Rim launched outside of us live-action. All of those now are going to be animated shows, movies.
Mm-hmm. Altered Carbon will be a spin-out movie.
Okay. And the other ones will be shows?
Yeah. Pacific Rim is going to be a series.
Yeah.
Yeah. John is, you know, handling that.
Yeah. Do you feel like this is the beginning of a heyday for animation?
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's only the beginning.
Yeah.
It's growing even bigger. I'm very excited for the future trajectory of our business.
Let me ask you about Devilman, because Devilman Crybaby, it has some aspects in its content that can be pretty hard to distribute. You know, you wouldn't be able to air it, for example, on television, in traditional television in the U.S. There's some pieces there that are kind of core to its storyline. Why is that appropriate for us?
I have a huge respect to the original manga, creator Go Nagai. Mr. Go Nagai is a very respected manga artist, and everyone respects him very much. In my view, Devilman tells the story of the dark side of human nature. And so it's a very compelling story. I don't want to be a spoiler, but you know, the Devilman is a story where in manga, demons are the native habitant of Earth. And that was a very surprising story.
Yeah.
And this demon hunting, starts. But in this demon hunting, it turned out that there are many dark side nature of, human races, species. And in an effort to depict that dark side of human nature, there are some violent scenes or, sexually explicit scenes.
And that happens to be part of our dark side.
Yeah. And if we believe such explicit depiction is necessary to achieve the intention of the storytelling, we are fully supporting the creator's motivation.
I'm curious to see what we'll do as we're able to put money into creative work and not put the control down, not tighten the screws down on the artist to see what happens. I'm excited that you're both kind of engaged in allowing that whatever comes out to work.
I think we're not trying to just exploit that opportunity we have, right? Just for the sake of it, so we can put violence or sex into shows. I think we're trying to enable really exceptional artistic vision, right? Yeah. So when you see Go Nagai, you see Yuasa-san, the director created, I think these are undeniable, huge talents with clear visions of the story they want to tell. And to Taito's point, we're enabling that.
It's really wonderful to be able to say to a creator, a potential person that come here, hey, you get creative freedom and 190 countries, 140 million people, whatever it is that today, it's really a wonderful thing to be able to say to a creator. When you sit down with creators, what are their trepidations? What are they saying? I'm not sure Netflix is the right place to go.
For example, the crews who are working with on Altered Carbon anime, they're very excited to work with the show. Many Japanese top crews want to do sci-fi stuff. But not that many Japanese anime fans would love to see sci-fi shows. But globally, people are waiting for sci-fi anime. And Altered Carbon is the project.
Yeah.
And so they are very excited. So this is an opportunity that satisfies the creators and aspiration to tackle a global level show.
Why are people in Japan not as interested in sci-fi manga anime?
There's always a trend in terms of the taste of core anime fans, and these days younger generations enjoy lean back comedy stuff, and which is not necessarily sci-fi, and sci-fi steampunk stuff was very strong about 10 or 15 years ago.
Interesting.
And those fans get older, and younger generations have a tendency to enjoy lean back and comedy shows.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Maybe because of the, contemporary zeitgeist, something, life is tough. So, yeah.
They want it lighter.
Yeah.
Well, but you have stuff like, something like One Punch Man, which is a massive franchise. Attack on Titan. These are massive franchises. I think the issue is in Japan, there's just so many anime fans. It's across a much broader swath of types of stories and genres.
Because
right?
There's so much audience in Japan.
I think that's part of it. But, there's some great sci-fi properties or fantasy properties. One thing I would add to Taito's point about what makes anime so unique is also just its unique ability to world build. Right, you can take IPs or stories that might almost be impossible to make in, say, fantasy, sci-fi, horror, and make them.
We talked earlier about it being challenging to hire people. What is it that makes it difficult to hire for your teams?
We are a tech company, and we are also an entertainment company. I believe, relatively, it's easier to find talents from tech companies' background people. Whereas in local market in Japan, entertainment executives, you know, spend longer time in one company mm-hmm. or two. And people are not used to changing careers and adapt themselves into fast-paced tech companies' working environment. That's one challenge.
So the entertainment industry has been around for a long time, and therefore people there, you know, maybe change one time in their life, they change companies. But in the tech world, because tech changes so quickly, there's a little bit more shifting around.
Exactly.
Uh-huh.
Our business changes a lot, right?
Yeah.
We've been growing so fast. You know, I've been here 6 years, I've had many jobs, and we move very quickly to opportunities. So we have to be able to really reconfigure ourselves and adjust our work to the opportunity. And I think that that's where having someone with a bit of more of a startup or tech mentality can be very helpful.
And that's one thing, of course, that you might get people that have more malleability of changing roles and changing what they're doing because they have over time in tech. But if you're looking for someone with entertainment expertise and they're not looking to change locations, it's very hard to hire them.
Yeah, there's, I just thought, you know, having another issue, you know, there are some people in entertainment industry who would like to be a gatekeepers, and, you know, being a gatekeeper can enhance your power.
Yeah.
But in this organization at Netflix, being gatekeeper is not allowed. Everyone is supposed to be a high functioning hub and having radical transparency in terms of, you know, any accessible information. And that is a radical change from the traditional media or entertainment organization. Yeah.
I mean, I think we've hired some fantastic people in this office, and I think all of them are kind of imbued with that spirit.
Yeah.
And so I think it's just a process of really finding, going out there, looking all around across lots of different organizations and really finding a way to explain the context of what we're trying to do here and bring people in that get excited about that.
Well, if you're getting excited and you're in Japan, especially if you're in Tokyo or willing to move to Tokyo and interested, take a look at jobs.netflix.com and maybe see if there's something fit for you. John, we are releasing 3 live action pieces this year produced in Japan.
Yeah.
And we haven't been doing that. Like, this is a new thing. How are we achieving it? What's going on? What's it like to do that?
It's super exciting and challenging and just rewarding. I think what we've done traditionally when we entered this market, like we do in a lot of markets when we enter, is we partner with local broadcasters. We try to start to learn about the appetite of our consumers and what they want to watch. And I think we're at a place now where we really want to make shows that feel very differentiated, feel like our cinema quality shows. And often that's not going to be a partnership with a broadcaster, right? They're more with working within the traditional ecosystem. They're making shows that are at a production value level and a budget level of that business. So what we're looking at these shows to do is really kind of define the Netflix brand as a place for like high quality cinematic experience. I mean, most of these projects, we're working with top directors, film directors. Mm-hmm. We're working with A-list cast. And they're shows with really uncompromising and really strong visions that I think if we put them beside a lot of our great successful Netflix shows, Narcos or 13 Reasons Why or Stranger Things, I think people around the world will look at them and really see them as of a piece with those visions.
I want to ask you, I'm a product side person, right? I make the Netflix applications better, or I'm with a lot of people that do that, right? What do we need to change in the product to make it more acceptable for a Japanese audience?
Especially in anime, this binge watching is increasing.
Yeah.
And people love to enjoy the episodes all at once. So some part of the industry is still dependent on DVD business, and it's very interesting phenomena where we see some shows is on free over-the-air broadcast weekly rollout basis. And after the 12th episode, then DVD sales will jump up. So this means fans watch shows all at once on DVR, then make a decision to buy DVD or not. Netflix is becoming to supplement that viewing behavior. So our original shows with global first run, all at once episode availability is creating a new norm, I'd say, for anime fans.
All right. I'm going to do a fun part of this, maybe fun for you.
Yeah, just waiting for this part.
What are you watching right now?
Tidying Up with Marie Kondo.
Are you doing Tidying Up with Marie Kondo?
I folded vertically. Yeah, that was a significant impact on me.
I agree. Me too.
And the story, I'd say, if Japanese crew made the same show, it wouldn't travel so globally. And
why?
It's, I don't know, maybe non-Japanese sometimes discover the value of, Japan-originated IP. And, I respect Marie Kondo. I might be wrong, to describe her as an IP, She's a very...
Konbari.
Konbari is a, wonderful, respected, figure. But it's all about the story of, each family.
Yeah.
And the story is great. And also this global internet TV platform is the media outlet for such a great storytelling. And otherwise, you couldn't discover this wonderful Marie Kondo and, family story. And so I'd say this is a surprising Netflix dreams comes true situation where Marie Kondo is already, celebrity in Japan, but she became even bigger global celebrity after the success of this show.
And you didn't start folding your laundry correctly until you watched it on Netflix, right? Even though she's a celebrity
here. It had to go all the way around the world first.
How about you, John? What are you watching?
I'm watching Umbrella Academy, almost done. I think it's a show that just revels in its uniqueness and not afraid to be itself and really kind of take its own courses. It works at its own pace, which I really admire. Yet it's a very big show for us, and it's a very successful show, and I love it.
Do you just like things that came from comic books? Is that the rule?
No, not at all. I love a wide variety of shows and programs. But when we're working in anime, it's a good organizing principle if someone's created a very compelling world, right? So when we think about shows we're going to commission, having that, we've announced we're doing a show based on one of Mark Millar's properties, Super Crux, and having, someone who's created in their mind a really fulsome world with all sorts of, heightened realms and heightened experience, I think that that's very helpful as we start down the process of creating a show in anime.
Yeah, I just want to add, going back to this subsidiary thing, Greg Peters once said, there is no subsidiary and there is only one global Netflix, one organization on a global basis, and including U.S. office, each regional office is equal.
Yeah.
That's the idea. So our organization is, flat. It's just about like a product, on this global internet TV, each regional content is treated equally.
Yeah.
And every customer of Netflix have equal opportunity to discover every regional content from all over the world. And our organization is designed like that.
I would add, I think this is one of our huge strengths as we kind of compete globally and start to make content around the world, which is one of the really big eye-opening things that we're doing at Netflix, which is, the U.S. is 4.4% of the global population. The U.S. doesn't have a lockdown on great storytelling by a long shot. And so I think what Netflix is doing right now is creating and giving a forum for great storytellers around the world to create. And that sort of diffusion of decision making that we have at Netflix will enable us to make great choices across Europe, Asia, Africa, all around the world, which is a great advantage for the company.
John and Taito, thank you so much for doing We Are Netflix with me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We Are Netflix is hosted by Lyle Troxell. He's a senior software engineer at Netflix. You can keep up with We Are Netflix on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. To learn more about careers at Netflix, go to jobs.netflix.com.